So the fundamental theorem of calculus is what lesson 5.3 about. Obviously, if you call something the fundamental theorem of calculus, it's going to be important. So there are two parts to it. We are going to use both parts in this video. So the fundamental theorem of calculus part one says that if you have a continuous function that is differentiable on the interval from A to B, then the main thing to remember is that the derivative of the integral is the function inside. The derivative of the integral is the function inside. So the derivative, you'll notice that g of x was an integral, but when we took its derivative, we got the function inside at x. Look where x is. X is your upper bound. It is the thing that you're plugging into the function. So again, the derivative of the integral is the function inside. So the derivative of an integral is the function being evaluated. The derivative of the integral is the function being evaluated. So g of x is the area, because it's the integral. When we go backwards, we get the function that created that area. So let's look at our first example. So we've got this function that is the integral from 0 to x of f of t dt. We see f of t on the page. So if we want g of 0, that is the integral from 0 to 0 of f of t dt. Well, the integral from 0 to 0 is nothing. We have no area that could be contained in that, so the answer is 0. Now they ask us to find g of 1. G of 1 is the integral from 0 to 1 of f of t dt. So that is just the area under the curve from 0 to 1. So it is a rectangular piece. Rectangles area are 1/2 base times height. So that's 1/2 base of 1, height of 2. That area is 1. Now they asked us to do g of 2, so that's the area from 0 to 2 of f of t dt. We already have the area from 0 to 1, so if we just add on that new piece, so we know that this area was 1. The next area is a rectangle, so you do base is 1, height is 2, that area is 2. So 1 plus 2 is a total area now of 3. G of 3 goes from 0 to 3 of f of t dt. We already know the first two pieces. Now we just have to add on this slice. And it says we want what that area is. You'll notice that it's really similar to our first chunk from 0 to 1. It's just slightly more curved. So we're going to have to make a guesstimate here. They did say a rough sketch. So it looks like that's 1 plus 2 plus another 1. So I would assume that's around 4. G of 4 is from 0 to 4 of f of t dt. So from 0 to 4, we know the first two areas. Now this area here, and I think this area here on top are similar. I think that if we call that top one 1, we should call that bottom one negative 1. They should cancel each other out. I think they're real similar. So that would be a 3. And then g of 5 is the area from 0 to 5 of our function f, which gives us another negative section. I would say we'll just call that negative 1 as well. And so now we're down to an area of 2. Now let's graph g on the same axis we did before. So let me erase some of my little stuff here. Excuse me. Here was our f function. Now let's make our g function. So g of 0 is at 0. G of 1 is 1. G of 2 is 3. G of 3 is 4. G of 4 is 3. G of 5 is 2. Okay, so if we were to make a rough sketch, sorry, it's so ugly. Our g function looks something like that. Now let's think for a minute. If we took the derivative of that, the derivative of g should be the red function inside. So it should be the red function. We know that derivatives indicate the slope of our tangent lines. So like, just let's look at a few places here. Our slope of our tangent line. Let's look at our slopes. Our slope here is positive. Then it's constant. Then look here, it's still positive. Now it's 0, 0, 0. Now it's a negative slope. In decreasing, and so on. So that kind of gives you an indication of how they go together, okay? Let's take a look at example two. It says to find the derivative of this function. The derivative of an integral should be the function inside, evaluated at your variable x. So it is just the square root of 1 plus x squared. That's it. The derivative of g is the integral, is the function that we were evaluating. So the answer is 1 plus x squared. Now that only works if it is 0 to a value of x. If our bounds are different, we might have to do a little bit of work. But for now, that's what you want to do if they ask you to find the derivative of an integral. The derivative of an integral is the function inside. So let's take a look at what happens if our bounds are not a number to x, but a number to a function h of x. Well, because of the chain rule, we must use substitution. We can use substitution. And look what happens. It is our function, plug in h of x, times the derivative of our function. And that all comes from what we know about our chain rule. So here's an example. And let's say we want to find the derivative of this integral from 1 to x to the 4th of the secant of t dt. Now, normally, it's just the function inside. So the derivative of this integral is the function inside, evaluated at our boundary. If it's x, you plug in x. But if it's an x to the fourth, we have to plug in x to the fourth. And we have to multiply by the derivative of x to the fourth, which is 4x cubed. So just be careful if they're asking you to find the derivative of an integral and the bound isn't a number to x, but it's a number to a function of x. We plug in that function of x and then multiply by the derivative of the inside. And it is a direct result of what we have to do for the chain rule. Now, here's the important one. The Fundamental Theorem of Calculus Part 2 basically says that if a function is integrable on the interval from A to B, then to evaluate the integral, all you're going to do is take the antiderivative of the function and plug in the upper bound minus the plug in of the lower bound. We write that, okay, so I'm going to write it a little bigger here. So if we have a function, we are evaluating its integral from A to B. It is the antiderivative plugging in B minus the antiderivative plugging in A. We can also write that as f of x evaluated from B to A. F of x evaluated from B to A. It's always upper bound minus lower bound. Upper bound minus lower bound. So that's why I wanted to explore our antiderivatives before we got into this, because now the shortcut method for an integral is an antiderivative, because the derivative of an integral is the function inside. So the integral must be the antiderivative, because it would be the opposite thing. So this is really important. Let's look at an example. Now, we've seen this example, the parabola of y equals x squared, evaluated from 0 to 1. We had done it in our first lesson about integrals. We had evaluated the area under the curve. We had done it estimates with rectangles, I'm sorry. Then we did it the long way. Now let's do it the shortcut way. So this means the integral from 0 to 1 of x squared dx. The antiderivative of x squared is x cubed divided by 3, and we're going to evaluate that from 0 to 1. So that's how you can write that notation. We are going to plug in the upper bound minus when we plug in the lower bound, which is 1/3. Much easier than all the other ways that we have done so far, because now we can just take the antiderivative, and it's the upper bound minus the lower bound. Let's look at another example. So let's find the area under the cosine curve from 0 to b, where b goes from 0 to pi over 2. So that goes from 0 to pi over 2 of the cosine of x dx. The antiderivative of cosine is a sine. We want to evaluate it from 0 to pi over 2. So that is the sine of pi over 2 minus the sine of 0. At pi over 2, the sine is 1. At 0, the sine is 0. Our area under the curve of a cosine curve from 0 to pi over 2 has a value of 1. So it is one perfect one unit of area underneath a cosine curve. So look at our cosine curve. It goes like that. That has an area of 1, which I think is kind of cool.
What about the cosine curve?
So remember, there are two pieces to the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. If f is a continuous curve from a to b, the derivative of an integral is a function inside. And then part two is that an integral can be evaluated by taking the antiderivative of the top bound minus the antiderivative of the bottom bound. So those are the two pieces you have to remember. So they've asked us to find the derivative of h. If h is an integral, you go, oh, that's easy. I just plug in the upper bound. And if my upper bound is a function of x, I got to remember to also multiply by the derivative. So h prime of x is the square root of 1 plus x squared cubed times the derivative of x squared, which is 2x. So that would be 2x square root of 1 plus x to the sixth. That's the derivative of h. So the derivative of an integral is the function inside. If you're plugging in a function of x, you must use the chain rule. So you need to plug it in and then also multiply by the derivative of the inside. Or not the inside, the original, the function you're plugging in. Let's take a look at example 7. Now we're taking antiderivative. It's a polynomial. So that means that we can take the antiderivative of each piece. So that would be x. Oh, I'm sorry, our function isn't x. That would be y. That would be 3y squared divided by 2 plus y cubed divided by 3. And we're going to evaluate it from 0 to 4. First, we're going to plug in our 4. So we've got 4 plus 3 halves times 16 plus 64 thirds. Now, be careful when you're subtracting your lower bound. Now, this is a case where lots of zeros happen, but don't assume that your back piece is always going to end up being 0. In this case, it is. It's 0 plus 0 plus 0. But I like to get in the habit even of zeros of putting minus the back piece, so then you remember to distribute or subtract the whole answer when you plug it in. And then so we get 4 plus 24 plus 64 thirds. 28. Which is 148 thirds. So if we were to actually graph that and look at the function from 0 to 4, that would be the area that is underneath that parabola. Here's example 8. Now, in example 8, just like any type of derivative, it is better served if I write that as a power instead of a radical. Now, I am evaluating an antiderivative of that. So the power goes up by 1, and then I divide by that power. When I divide by a fraction, I like to just multiply by its reciprocal. Remember, I am plugging in the upper bound minus the lower bound. So that's 3 fourths, 8 to the 4 thirds, minus 3 fourths, 0 to the 4 thirds. Now, remember how a fractional exponent works. The bottom acts like a radical, the top acts like a power. So the cubed root of 8 is 2, 2 to the 4th is 16. So that's 3 fourths times 16, and then minus 0, which is 12. And so that's example 8. Let's look at example 9. Again, I don't like the way that this piece right here is written. Remember, that's really x times x to the 1/2. So I would write this as x to the 3/2 before I take the antiderivative. So now I'm taking the antiderivative of both pieces. So that's going to be 3x plus x to the 5/2, but I need to divide by 5/2, so I tack on a 2/5, and then I'm evaluating from 0 to 1. When I plug in 1, I get 3 plus 2/5, minus when I plug in 0, so that's 15/5 plus 2/5. Which is 17/5. So you'll notice that the function is a piecewise function. From negative pi to 0, it's just x. So then from 0 to pi, it's sine of x. So this integral wants the us to evaluate the area from negative pi to positive pi. So let's split it up. Let's make that from negative pi to 0 of x dx plus the area from 0 to pi of the sine of x dx. Now we're just going to take the antiderivative of both pieces individually. And so this is going to be x squared divided by 2. And we're going to go from negative pi to 0. And this is going to be the negative cosine of x from 0 to pi. And now we're just going to evaluate those at the upper and lower bound. So it's, remember, it's upper bound minus lower bound. So we're going to do 0 minus negative pi squared over 2 plus negative cosine of pi minus negative cosine of 0. So be careful about your signs here. Our front sign, the negative pi squared becomes a positive pi squared, but there's a negative in front, so that's negative pi squared over 2. Cosine of pi is negative 1, but there's a negative in front, so that's plus 1. Cosine of 0 is positive 1, but there's two negatives there, so that's positive 1. So our final answer is 2 minus pi squared over 2. And that is the integral from negative pi to positive pi. So those are some examples of how we use the antiderivative to evaluate an indefinite integral. Or I'm sorry, a definite integral. And here are the problems that I want you to do.